Android 11. Over to you, Jatin.
Hi everyone. Before I start my session, I would definitely like to call out what a great introduction to this event was, and it was quite thoughtful. And I personally felt really great watching all those videos, and I hope everyone in the live stream also felt the similar. So yeah, without any delay, let me start my session. My session is around what's new in Android 11. So my name is Jitin Sharma. I work as an Android engineer at Gojek. I'm a Google developer expert for Android also. And this session is around what kind of behavior changes you can expect in OS as Android 11 comes up. And you know, what kind of APIs, libraries, and you know, tools and goodies are available to developers with the new release of Android. So Android 11 is in beta right now. So if you are part of the beta program, whether you have a Pixel device or any other device, you should be able to get the second preview, which is quite bug free till now, but they are still accepting bug requests. If you find any bug, do report it to Google and you can try it out. You can try out Android 11 right now. So starting with like what's new in Android 11, let's start with UI. So the first thing which Android 11 has built in a new UI is window insets. So window insets, it's not a new API. It's an API which has existed from like earlier versions of Android. It's revamped in the newer versions of Android with Android 11 to provide, you know, better information about what kind of content is being displayed on the screen. So the content could be like status bar, navigation bar, or IME. IME is like the one of the most important example where this window inset API comes into play. So if you want to use the window inset API, you can just do set on apply window inset listener, which will give you the view and the inset. So the first thing which we can do is we have different types of window insets, like window inset.type.ime. IME is the you know, virtual keyboard which you see on your devices. So now we have actually an API to actually see whether the keyboard is visible or not. There was no standard way to do this till now, which is kind of very bad because applications which have a lot of form inputs always struggle with these things. But now with Android 11, we have an API to check whether keyboard is visible or not, and then get insets around this IME. Basically, you know, get the size of the keyboard and what kind of content on the screen the keyboard is occupying. So we have APIs to get all this data. Earlier, you could do this with, there were multiple ways to do this, but nothing was more reliable. But this is the most reliable way to do starting from Android 11. Once you get, you know, the handle of IME, whether it's visible or not, the second thing which you want to do is, you know, animate your UI or animate the IME, the keyboard itself according to your UI. So this is again very important for applications, you know, which show form-related data or any kind of input, because as keyboard comes up, it takes up the content of a lot of content in your screen, and you might want to, you know, update. You might want to animate the UI of your screen according to how keyboard is coming, like depending on how much height it is taking and how fast is it coming or how slow it is coming. Again, there was no API to do this earlier. There were like, you could listen to global layouts and then, you know, calculate height yourself. But now you can actually do these things. So there are two ways of handling this animation. One is system driven, where, you know, system opens the keyboard for you and gives you callback, and you can update your UI according to this, according to that callback. This is the left animation which you see. On the right side, what you do is you take the control away from the system of opening the keyboard. And depending on, you know, use cases or animations of your app, you can actually force open the keyboard with a sort of animations which work well with your UI. So for the first case, what you do is you use window insert animation dot callback, which can be applied to, let's say, edit text, which represents the, you know, input type. Once you use these callbacks, you get, you know, override functions like on progress, on start, on end. So these basically tell you how the keyboard is opening up from the bottom. And as keyboard opens up, you get continuous callbacks. And you using those callbacks, you can animate your UI to go upward or downward, depending on how it is going up. And then you can also know, on start and on end, to know when the callback has started and when callback has ended. So this basically allows you to listen to the changes of the keyboard height, and then animate your UI accordingly. For the other thing where you want to take the control, basically you can take the control using window inset controller dot control window inset animation. This allows you to control the animation of the insets. So if we take the type IME here, we can take the control and then open it. We can even pass things like linear interpolator. So in this case, it's a linear interpolator, which means we want the keyboard to open in a linear motion. But you can have some other kind of interpolators also, your custom path interpolator, and you can define the how motion will be there. And then you can also get callbacks like, ready, canceled, and finished to know when the animation has finished or if it was canceled. Window insets have multiple types. IME is one of them. So IME represents your keyboard related motion. Display cutout represents notch, but unlike IME, which are dynamic because they can come and go, notch is not something which is dynamic because it's like a physical part of the phone. So, but you can still get the insets of the notch using inset type dot display cutout. And then you also have system bars. So system bar represents the navigation bar here. So navigation bar can or cannot be dynamic. It may or may not also be present, depending if the user has enabled the navigation bar on the bottom instead of using the motion-based gestures. So yeah, again, if you have use case, you can also use system bar window inset type to animate your UI depending on whether system bars are visible or not. You can look at this sample, whatever code sample I showed, using this link. So it has the whole link of it has the whole code of window insert animations, whether it's system driven or user driven. Conversations. So conversations is the second biggest change when it comes to even OS level UI. So conversation is very important because as we use our phones, a lot of time we use our phones are for conversations only, whether we are talking to a person on WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, Slack, or whatever. So conversation is important part of our daily life. So what Android 11 does is it has a separate pane in the notification bar, in the notification window for conversation itself. And right now it was not there, and it is possible that some important conversation might get lost in the sea of notifications, as a lot of apps might send you a lot of notifications. But now you have a separate window for it, and all your conversations reside in this window. Also, these conversation entries in this window have priorities. You can define what kind of conversation you want to be on priority or alerting or silent. If it's silent, you won't get notification for it. You can set priority also, which means, this is an important conversation. I need to get back to it whenever someone replies. And then it also goes to the top of the bar because it's a priority notification. You can set alerting notifications also, which will still send you an alert, but they are a bit lower on the priority than the priority notifications. Also, the UI has changed a bit. If you look closely, you have a number count also on the right, and you can see the people's photo on the left. So these are all part of the standard APIs, and all the applications which use this API will look like this. So let's say if you have a chat app and you want your chat notifications to be part of the conversation panel in Android 11. So first thing you need to do is build a person. So person is also an existing API in Android. Some of you might have used it earlier. And then you have to create a shortcut now. So shortcut, again, existing API to actually build shortcuts, app shortcuts. But now shortcut info compact builder takes a person as a builder function. So you can set the person to it and then push this dynamic shortcut. Once you have done that, then you can start creating your notification. So for conversation panel, the notification has to be created in a messaging style notification. If you have a chat app, you might have been doing this if you have that inline reply button on the notification, so that using messaging style. If you're not, you need to use this if you want your notification in Android 11 to be in the conversation panel. And in this notification, you can set the shortcut ID of the shortcut which you have built right now using the shortcut info compat builder. And once you do that, your notification should start coming in the conversation panel. And then user can set the alert accordingly, whether he wants your notifications to be priority or not. Building on top of this, we have bubbles. So bubbles are like a resizable activity which float around your system UI, irrespective of which app is open. So bubbles is something which has recently moved to a stable API. It was present as a developer option in Android 10, so for users to try out and you know how to do it. So now in 11, they are stable. They are better than system alert window, which was the previous alternative to do this kind of stuff, which you know apps like Facebook Messenger use. So now there is a API for doing the exact this thing. Bubbles are also created using the notification API. So it's the same API, just you can create the bubble using the exact same API. So let's say you want your activity to be resizable, you know, you want a bubble activity. So first thing which you need to do is have resizable activity tag as true in manifest. Once you have that, you can create an intent for your activity, the activity which has to be resized. And then what you create is a bubble metadata within the notification itself. You have to set a shortcut ID. So shortcut is something which we saw how we build in the slides few slides ago. So you use the same concept here and create a shortcut ID. Once you set the shortcut ID in the bubble metadata, then you can create a notification with that metadata. Once you push this notification, a bubble gets created in the system UI, and then that whenever user clicks on that button, and the activity gets maximized, and then you can minimize or close it as well. So yeah. Privacy. So, coming from like Android 9, 10, even Android 11 has a lot of stuff added for privacy, which we saw in like earlier releases also. Android is, you know, moving towards more and more, you know, privacy and security of the user. So a highlight of what's happening in privacy in Android 11 is that you have APIs for accessing what kind of data your application is, you know, requesting. A lot of changes have been done into foreground and background services, especially around location. There is changes to package visibility. There is scope storage, and you know there is a concept of auto reset permissions. So this is just a highlight. I won't be going into details of this because there is a session right after my session around you know how you adapt your apps to the privacy changes by Saurabh Arora. So stay tuned in for that session, and he will go over the details of few of these things. So let's look at developer goodies, what we get as Android 11 comes. The first thing is wireless ADB. So wireless ADB is something which is now system itself is supporting, and it's really good because you don't have to now care about hassles of all the wires, type C, type non-type C, or whatever kind of charging your phone supports. And wireless ADB was something which is still present, but basically you have to use ADB and you know set TCP ports. It's quite not reliable, but with the system native support in Android 11, this will become a lot reliable, and yeah, so it will help a lot. Android Studio version 4.2 is introducing support for this. Basically what will happen in Android Studio 4.2, you can actually generate a QR code within Android Studio, and you can scan the QR code in your mobile, and then your laptop and mobile will get wirelessly connected via ADB. So that should be really great to have a you know simpler connection than using the wires. Nullability annotations. So some important nullability annotations have been added. This is really important because as a lot of code bases start moving over to Kotlin, these annotations become really important because using Kotlin with platform types where you know SDKs, Android SDKs are written in Java where nullability was not really enforced, can actually cause errors or crashes. So right now, if you use variables or function return types with you know @nullable or @non-null, they produce errors if they are not used correctly. If you use a nullable value as a non-null value in your own code base, they produce error. But right now, Framework is adding more and more annotations to the existing APIs. So what they are actually doing is they will add something called recently nullable and recently non-null. It's a warning to you that, you know, this return type has recently changed its nullability type. So it's a heads up, you know, you might want to change the code base, but it won't actually fail the build because it creates a warning. But in the next major release of Android, let's say something was recently nullable in Android 11, it will become nullable in Android 12. So then you might start getting errors depending on how you're using it. So warnings are a good way to incrementally update your code base as things change. Crash reporting API. This is like one of the most exciting APIs, which is part of Android 11. So you can actually query why your application has why your application was crashed. So what you do is from the activity manager, you get a new method called get historical process exit reasons, and it lists down the reasons why your application has crashed over the lifetime of the OS. So reasons could be like few of these. Let's say reason low memory. Your application crashed because system was on low memory, or reason crash. So reason crash is like just any crash which might have occurred in your code. So crashes are something which I'm pretty sure any stable application would be using a reporting service like Firebase Crashlytics or some other reporting service. So reason crash is something which you probably are already tracking. But crash reporting services often struggle to find out things like, you know, your application might have been closed due to low memory, or even ANRs. Like ANRs are something which you can get through Android Vitals, but generally crash reporting services struggle to find out ANRs. But now with this API, you can actually find out ANRs, and you can find out ANRs and log them in your own server. Other things are like reason user requested. So this reason comes when user will force stop your application from the settings. So this can happen due to a lot of reason why user will force stop. One is like your application might be consuming a lot of battery, and Android often pops up a window like this application is consuming a lot of battery, and it comes up with a force stop button. So user might click that. So this might be a area for you to see. If you get a lot of reason user requested in your data, then your app might be consuming a lot of battery. And then reason permission change. So this happens. When runtime permissions have been changed in background, either by user or by the system. Since Android 11 can auto reset permissions, so your app might crash due to that also. So you can query for that reason also. So you can all use all these reasons, and you can push these reports to your own server and have a chart of all these things to basically find out like what are the various areas where your app is crashing and what you can do about it. All of these come with a description, a timestamp, and a lot of information around them, like why a certain reason might have happened. So you get a lot of data around this which you can look over. ADB incremental. So ADB has a incremental mode right now. So what incremental mode means, if you have a huge APK, especially if you are building games where APK sizes can go into hundreds of MBs or even GBs, incremental allows you to incrementally install the APK using ADB. So you can see this graph where without ADB incremental, this APK required 68 seconds, but with incremental it required only 7 seconds. So this is like a huge change in amount of time it takes to push APK via ADB. If you want to use this, you can just do ADB install and send a flag on incremental. Even if you are not building games, this might be useful for even apps which have like huge APK size. Like personally, I work with an app where debug APK size go over like 100 MB. And we often use command line tools to build our application instead of Android Studio, and then push our application using ADB. So using ADB in that case with incremental flag can save a couple of seconds of your build time. So definitely something to try out. So behavior changes. So since there are a lot of behavior changes which are coming in Android 11, your applications may break in different regions of your app due to some reason or other. So how do you test these behavior changes? First of all behavior changes only occur when you start targeting the Android SDK version 30 or R. So if you're not targeting that version, your applications won't be affected. If you are doing that, there is a UI in the developer options called the app compatibility changes. So what you can do here is basically in isolation, you can turn on and off features. Like you can turn on scope storage feature, you can turn off, you know, GWP ASAN feature, or you can turn off. So what it allows you to do is turn on one feature and you test your app in the isolation of that feature. You know, what areas of my app is scope storage breaking. So it's really good for testing out, you know, which platform changes is breaking which part of your app. So you can definitely use this. You can also do this via command line using ADB shell, and you can pass around these keys called, let's say, default scope storage to your application. The definition of all these keys which are written here in the slide are present in the developer documentation, so you can look over them. Coming to graphics and media, so Android 11 supports something called animated HEIF images. So HEIF is not really a popular format, but it's kind of gaining momentum. It's a animated format similar to GIFs, but it's like very small and more performative. So Android 11 is a native support for, you know, converting HEIF images into animated image drawables. So what you do is you use Image Decoder API for this. Image Decoder API was introduced in Android 10 as a standard replacement for Bitmap Factory. So if you have a HEIF file, you can create a source out of it. Then you can decode this file using a method called decode driver. And then if it's an animated kind of file, then you can, you know, cast it as animated image driver, and then you can start the animation. So Image Decoder, again, I would like to call out, it's like a really nice API. It was not added in Android 11, but in Android 10, but like it has been improved in Android 11. It allows you to basically decode a lot of images and do transformations also, which was earlier not possible, like, you know, set a sample size or even target size, which you can do. So yeah, definitely something to try out. There's more. So 5G, Android has like now API support for 5G also. This is added in Connectivity Manager, which is a system service. So you can check for capability called, you know, net capability not metered, and find out what kind of 5G network the phone is running on. And you can even check like downstream bandwidth and compare it with whether what you consider as a fast network or not. And if it is a fast network, you might want to, you know, change the way you do network calls, which you might not do on a, let's say, 3G or 4G phone. 5G is not something which is present in India right now at a, you know, cellular telecom level, but phones have been present now, which 5G supports. Hopefully by next year, we will start having like 5G support. So this is something which you guys can keep in mind as these capabilities come out. Biometric authenticator strength. So biometric authenticator strength is like a way to know how much biometrics has user enabled in his phone. So this is really good for like finance related apps where, you know, you might want to keep access to other areas of your applications to only, you know, certain people, to only if the biometric is enabled, let's say fingerprint or face scanner. So you can actually set a strength from the authenticators, let's say biometric strength strong, you know, I want the biometric strength to be strong, only then I will allow this region of my app to be operable. And then you can check the existing strength. So if it is not, then you can basically ask the user to enroll into biometric security, whether it's, you know, fingerprint or face recognition. And once he does that, then he can access the area of your app. Autofill keyboard integration. So autofill is something which was present. It has been there since few versions of Android. It allows you to basically autofill any form which is present in your native app with a dropdown. Basically, you see a lot of stuff in dropdown, whether it's your email, house address or email address. Autofill now has an integration with keyboard, which means all the autofill suggestions now get pushed to the keyboards. So this is basically how it looks like. Since keyboards, most of the modern keyboards have suggestion tab on the top where they, you know, they show spelling suggestion or something like that. Now what autofill can do is it can push its own suggestion directly into the keyboard. it actually doesn't send the data. So the keyboards actually don't access your data, whether it's your email address, password, or even credit card number. But it actually pushes request and response. So the whole UI itself is pushed. This is what it looked like. And this UI could be for anything. Like it could be for a address, email address. It could be a card number, or even, you know, house address. So this is really good if you're building a keyboard app. So if you are building a keyboard app, then basically how you can do is you can use this method to create inline suggestions. So inline suggestion request, so you can request what kind of autofill suggestions you would want in your keyboard. Let's say you don't want payment related stuff, you can not request that. And then what you get is response. So as I said, keyboards actually don't receive the data itself. Like data could be like the address or the email address. They actually receive a response, and this response can be used to show the UI in the pane of the keyboard. So that's how you can do it. So yeah, really good integration. If you are a keyboard app developer, then you should definitely look into this. Resource loader. So resource loader, another new API within Android 11. This basically allows you to dynamically load assets and resources, like drawables or, you know, colors or anything else. You can even override existing resources by having the same key name, or you can have new resources downloaded from the server. So resource loader adds two new APIs. One is resources provider, and second is the loader itself. The loader can be added to the base resources of the app. So resources provider can then create a provider from, let's say, load from directory or load from APK. Now this directory or APK can come from your own server over the air, and it has all the data. It has all the new, you know, resources, whether it's like an asset file or a drawable file or a values file. So once you download them and they are added to the base resources of your application, next time you request a drawable or a value by another key, you get the new one which you downloaded from your own server. So yeah, pretty good API. So non-platform. So there are a lot of non-platform changes which have been there. For example, Jetpack now has 70 libraries. There have been a new developments, like we have Hilt, which is a extension of sort of Dagger, and it allows you to, you know, set up Dagger with less boilerplate code, gives you a lot of extensions and functions. Paging 3.0 is available with coroutine supports, and CameraX is now in beta. So yeah, a lot of libraries which are being released every 2 weeks. So good stuff. Jetpack Compose, I think everyone might have heard of it. So Jetpack Compose is a new UI toolkit for Android. It's a reactive way to write UI and completely Kotlin based without any XML or something like that. It's in pre-alpha right now, being developed in the open. So a lot of feedback is being taken by the Android team. So you can head over to the Kotlin Lang Slack channel if you want to basically try out Jetpack Compose and give feedback to the people. So yeah, definitely something worth trying out. So yeah, with this, I would like to end this session. So there are a lot of things in Android 11 which I might not have covered because there are so many API changes. So I did not cover all of them in due to time constraint. But you are definitely welcome to look at the developer website to do this and check out what kind of features might you know, fit into your applications. And definitely give feedback to the Android team using, you know, Google issues. So yeah, so that's it from my side. I think there is a session, Q&A session after all these sessions. So if you have any questions, do post them in the comments, or if you have been given a form link, I will be taking up those session in the later Q&A, ask me anything session. So thank you everyone. Bye.